being justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God publicly displayed as a propitiation in his blood through faith. Now listen, this was to demonstrate his righteousness, because in the forbearance of God he passed over sins previously committed. For the demonstration, I say, of his righteousness at the present time, so that he would be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Who is right, Paul or this investigative judgment thing? Do you see the depth of error that is the central pillar of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? And it's time that the evangelical church wakes up and understands what this is.
All right, how's everyone doing? Have a good day so far? All right, let's stand to worship our God.
The grace of God has reached for from the raging sea, and I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. power to raise the dead. Who can save us from our sin? He is our hope, our righteousness. Jesus, only Jesus. Who can make the blind to see? Who holds the key? Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone is solid ground. Firm through the fiercest round and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are stilled, when striving
unfathomable love that you would take our place, guilty sinners. And we stand on this rock of salvation. We trust in your name. May your name be praised. Amen.
Good evening. I'm Richard Tinker, president of Life Assurance Ministries. So glad to see more people here this evening have come out. Thank you for coming. That song that we just sang, Till He Return or Call Me Home, just a few hundred yards to the south of us, they sing it differently. Till He Returns and Calls Me Home. Very important difference. Think about it. Or and. The writers of the song actually wrote it with or, which is biblically correct. Well, tonight is a really cool night. We have two apologists here who are going to be speaking to us, Paul Carden and Jim Baber. And they spoke last year, and I think they got a lot of views on YouTube also. But I'll start with Paul. He is the executive director of the Centers for Apologetics Research. And he has lots of things he's done, like 40 years of his life he's spent doing cult-related research and outreach in Latin America, Africa, Eastern Europe, and even former Soviet Union. And he was worked with Walter Martin and at the Christian Research Institute. And he was also the co-host of the live radio show Bible Answer Man back in the day. And but that's data that you can read in here. I worked with him on his board for 6 years, and that was a really special time to get to know the inner workings of another ministry. It helped me in leading this ministry. And godly men that care about apologetics, it was a gift of him to invite me to do that. But the other thing that's special about him is he's listened to former Adventists. You know, Jim and Paul both have taken time to actually hear what we have to say, hear our stories, and understand what we're going through and where we've come from. Paul even went on tour with us to Michigan. We've gone to Michigan 3 times to present near Andrews University. And he was there. And he's gone on tours with us of Loma Linda University. He toured with us through Andrews University and also the Adventist Village in Battle Creek. Those are special times, right? Yeah. So these were unauthorized tours where Colleen and I led the tour. And I don't think the campus even knew what was going on. But it was a lot of fun to see some of the things they had to offer and show and tell. And we went down and saw Ellen White's handwritten sheet of manuscript and watched the Adventists hold it like they were holding the hand of God almost. It was, anyway. And Jim, James Baber, the other man is speaking, he's director of Academy Apologia. And he does research amongst many different cults, including Adventism. But Adventism has kind of grabbed his attention lately. He's spending a lot of time on that project. And even so far as to coming to our house and recording some of his podcasts in our little tiny studio with Steve Pitcher on the Clear Word. Steve wasn't able to go down to his, so he's been driving up here and doing that. So it's really cool when people that haven't been Adventists get us, understand. So I just wanted you to welcome first Paul and then Jim.
Good evening. We're going to try and get the technical side of this. from the start. Thank you, Richard. You were more than gracious, as always. I'd like to meet this person you were talking about. If he shows up this weekend, please introduce us. So, my first slide. So why would I be talking about this now, here? If I'm talking about counter-cult apologetics and trying to establish the rudiments of a New Testament basis for such an animal as counter-cult apologetics, why would I take so much trouble to bring it to you? Because I'm guessing that for the most part I would be preaching to the converted. So I'll give a little more explanation. I spend a lot of time in Africa, but I need to qualify that. I spend more time than the average American physically in Africa, which in my case usually amounts to 1 or 2 weeks a year, working with our teams in East and Southern Africa. But all the rest of the year, I'm in Africa, or could I say Africa is on my mind every single day, not just that I'm in the news. I'm communicating with our teams on the ground. I'm on social media with Africans. And I have come to bring this message tonight because something is weighing on my heart. In fact, this is an adaptation I think I indicated just a moment ago. This is a presentation that I developed for Africa. Why would that be? It's been modified for your consumption. So I'm not going to say anything spooky or strange that only Africans would get. But I have found, quite shockingly, in countries that are, in some cases, 80% Christian, supposedly, professing Christians in denial that there are spiritual predators in the church. They will defend false teachers who have been caught dead to rights, teaching outrageous heresy and committing acts that should land them in prison for a long time, and attacking people like us who are attempting to warn the church. And what I hear from them, one could say, is something along these lines. Next. What's your problem? What is the big deal? Live and let live. Well, these are Africans talking. Who appointed you judge over everyone? You're just heresy hunters. You just hate everybody. Is this what you call Christian love? Just preach the truth and let God handle the rest. Fault finders. I submit to you that the real problem, if we could sum it up, is more along these lines. Christ and the New Testament authors give believers many warnings, instructions, and commands about deceivers who target the people of God. And three specific kinds of deceiver stand out in the New Testament text, at least I think so. False Christs, Jesus himself warned us about those, false prophets, and false apostles, all of them claiming to have special divine knowledge, power, and authority. People to be reckoned with, people one does not easily ignore when they show up. And I submit to you that their inspiration, according to the New Testament, is both carnal and demonic. So, any African friends who are watching tonight, was this only a first century phenomenon that I'm talking about here tonight, that I'm going to document in just a few moments? Or is it a today thing? And in fact, are such people among us now? Next, what does the Bible tell us? Let the scripture speak. Next. Here's how the Bible characterizes what I call unrepentant deceivers, a very specific category of person, not somebody who's, you know, off in a shed someplace believing falsehoods and not bothering anyone. Unrepentant deceivers, false Christs, Matthew 24, false prophets, Mark 13, false teachers, 2 Peter 2, super apostles, 2 Corinthians 11, savage, ravenous wolves, Matthew 7, Acts 20. You don't have to write all these down. I can give them to you at the end if you'd like. Ungodly persons, Jude 4, evil people, says Timothy. Next. Did I jump? False Christ, false prophets, imposters, 2 Timothy. Deceitful workers, 2 Corinthians 11. Hypocritical liars with seared consciences, 1 Timothy 4. Men of depraved mind, 2 Timothy 3. Worthless in regard to the faith, 2 Timothy 3. Stains and blemishes, 2 Peter 2. Rebellious, Titus 1. Next. Empty talkers, Titus 1. Untaught, writes Peter in his second letter. Unstable, unscrupulous, he writes in the same letter. Ungodly, Jude 4. Grumblers, finding fault, Jude 16. And they are greedy. Almost in every instance, we have reason to believe that they are greedy, 2 Peter 2. The New Testament authors write about those who are following after their own lusts. Again, this isn't just describing wayward saints of some description or just nominal believers. These are people who are professing to have some kind of divine authority for their assault on the faith. They're following after their own lusts. Really? Well, here's the thing that makes us different from the New Testament authors and people like Peter and Paul and John. I believe that they had special discernment, I'm serious, into the motives of the false teachers. We cannot always, with absolute confidence, encounter someone who is teaching untrue doctrine and know their motives. But I believe, from the evidence of Scripture, that the New Testament authors knew what the motives of these people of whom they spoke and wrote, what their motives were. And so I will not arrogate such an ability to myself, but I take it very seriously when they say that people are not only following after their own lusts, they are slaves of their own appetites, Romans 16. They're of depraved mind and deprived of the truth, and suppose that godliness is a means of gain, 1 Timothy 6. In fact, in the worst cases, they have eyes full of adultery that never cease from sin, and hearts trained in greed, 2 Peter 2. Next. Now, some are outwardly humble. We might think of a false prophet or two who might be regarded as such by certain people. While others are openly boastful and self-exalting, 2 Corinthians 11. They speak arrogantly, Jude 16. They reject authority, Jude 8, 2 Peter 2. They're self-centered and reckless. And in fact, 1 Timothy 6, the one who advocates a different doctrine and does not agree with sound words and with a doctrine conforming to godliness is conceited. And by the way, you know it all, heretics. According to Paul, you understand, really understand, nothing. So, the real problem I submit to you, have I jumped a slide? Yes, I did. Look at that. Look at that. We continue. Speaking of their methods and motives, they oppose the truth, which might be self-evident at this point. They use trickery and craftiness and deceitful scheming, Ephesians 4. How often have you heard it said of some false teacher, well, they don't really mean any harm. But in fact, in all too many cases, they do. They are the intentionality of their error and their tactics in carrying it out is somewhat breathtaking. They disguise themselves as sheep, Matthew 7, apostles of Christ, 2 Corinthians 11, servants of righteousness, 2 Corinthians 11. Next. They deceive with false words, 2 Peter 2, empty words, Ephesians 5, empty deception in accordance with human tradition and the elementary principles of the world, Colossians 2. They use persuasive arguments, Colossians 2, smooth and flattering speech, Romans 16. And indeed, they use flattery for the sake of gaining an advantage. It's really all about them in the end. Next. They cause dissensions. They're divisive, Romans 16. They entice unstable souls. They know how to size you up, 2 Peter 2. They employ stealth. For example, in Jude 4, they have crept in unnoticed. 2 Peter 2, they secretly introduce destructive heresies. 2 Timothy 3, some of them slip into households and they captivate their victims. Next. And as if this were not bad enough, oh yes, they are like hidden reefs in your love feasts, Jude 12. They're false brothers, in fact, who Paul, writing now about events in the book of Acts, sneaked in to spy on our freedom in order to enslave us. They exploit others, 2 Corinthians 11. I like the King James expression. They make merchandise of you. They disrupt whole households for the sake of dishonest gain. Next. They devour, 2 Corinthians 11. They defraud, Colossians 2. They lie, 1 Timothy 4. They produce counterfeit writings. Really? 2 Thessalonians 2. They distort the gospel of Christ, Galatians 1. They're physically abusive, 2 Corinthians 11. They deny the master who bought them. And indeed, deny our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ, Jude 4. Next. So, these persons, their methods and motives are varied, but there's a theme here. They take their stand on the basis of visions. Imagine that. They delight in the worship of angels, Colossians 2. They're always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth, 2 Timothy 3. They disparage all the things that they do not understand, Jude 10. They use abusive speech where they have no knowledge, 2 Peter 2. They don't understand either what they're saying or the matters about which they make confident assertions. Again, is this reminding you of anything, of anyone? And next, although they profess to know God, by their actions, they deny him and are, in fact, detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. So, they promote another Jesus, 2 Corinthians 11, a different spirit, 2 Corinthians 11, a different gospel. They promote demonically inspired teachings, 1 Timothy 4, 1 John 1, false knowledge. Next, they promote useless speculation, 1 Timothy 1, fruitless discussion, 1 Timothy 1, worthless stories. Maybe you've heard some, 1 Timothy 4, perverse and distorted things, Acts 20, indecent behavior, Jude 4, and not surprisingly, myths. Now, I cannot explore all the dimensions and dynamics of this problem, this threat here tonight. And the names and faces change over time. The tricks and tactics vary from one individual to another. But again, what I've just been sharing with you to this point is what we as God's people, are up against. Not people who are just casually confused or ignorantly opinionated. Unrepentant, spiritual predators. The people I'm talking about, and the scripture is warning us against, are on a mission from hell. And I do not believe I overstate the matter. Next. Now, of course, not all false teachers exhibit all of these characteristics, even after 40 years. I would find it very difficult to find a false teacher who hits every single one of these marks perfectly. But any combination of the foregoing is deadly stuff. The list demonstrates at least two key truths. First of all, the problem isn't just real, it's severe. And that, number two, every believer is a target. Because, and I'll say it again, the deceivers are, in most cases, predatory and acting intentionally. Actively seeking to exploit the ignorance, the naivete, the moral weakness, and other vulnerabilities of their prey in order to gratify their own desires. As Paul wrote to Timothy in his second letter, evil people and imposters will proceed from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. Next. And I jumped again. Look at that. So, spiritual counterfeiters, these people of whom I've been talking these few minutes, tactically they mount assaults on the church that are in some cases frontal, in some cases subtle. But make no mistake, they attack Christ himself, almost invariably, if not directly by implication. They undermine the unity of his church, and in effect, they bar the door to heaven for their victims. They often operate individually, as singular personalities. Maybe they'll have a podcast or a series of books or a radio program or some such thing. They might be super duper influencers. But very often they operate and promote their errors institutionally through superficially Christian churches, societies, fellowships, and so on. So I propose to you that the threat they pose to believers calls for both individual and institutional responses. And again, I would say that in considering what we should do in response to such people, I'd say that paranoia is not best, even though someone reading all those scriptures could be justified in having a rather wide-ranging fear of anyone who comes with a variation on something that the Bible may teach. The best response to these people in this phenomenon is what I call biblical vigilance. And it's a matter of knowing your enemy and knowing yourself. And I propose that Scripture tells us what the attitude should be for our attitude toward deceivers. Next. And ourselves and the deceived. So our attitude, our posture toward deceivers. Again, vigilance, watchfulness. Colossians 2. See to it that there is no one who takes you captive. It helps to know that people are looking to do this. Take care that no one keeps defrauding you of your prize, Colossians 2. Keep your eye on those who cause dissensions and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you've learned, and turn away from them, Romans 16. Knowing this beforehand, be on your guard so that you are not carried away by the error of unscrupulous people and lose your own firm commitment. 2 Peter 3. And of course, we must have a willingness to call out unrepentant spiritual counterfeiters and their organizations by name when it is necessary and appropriate to do so. Next. But then again, what should our attitude be toward ourselves? You could say that the church keeps these people in business. Does it not? 2 Timothy 4, for the time will come when they will not tolerate sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance with their own desires. Who's the they in this passage? Non-Christians? No. People in the churches, sadly. And they will turn away their ears from the truth and will turn aside to myths. Jude 17 and following. You, beloved, remember the words that were spoken beforehand by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, that in the last time there will be mockers following after their own ungodly lusts, who cause divisions. They're worldly minded, devoid of the truth. But you, beloved, you and me, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking forward to the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to eternal life. Next. Therefore, let the one who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. And then our attitude toward the deceived. Not the victimizers, not the predators, but their victims, the people who have been deluded by such folks. Cautious compassion. 2 Timothy 2, the Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but instead be kind to all, skillful in teaching, patient when wronged, with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition, if perhaps God may grant them repentance, leading to the knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. Jude 22 and 23, have mercy on some who are doubting. Save others, snatching them out of the fire. And on some have mercy with fear, hating even the garment polluted by the flesh. James 5, my brothers and sisters, if anyone among you strays from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that the one who has turned a sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Next. So, our responsibility as Christians means that we must clearly understand that the antidote for deception, doctrinal deception, spiritual deception, is biblical discernment. Which is to say, discernment that requires data. It requires data of two kinds. And here we come into the realm of countercult apologetics, if you will. Discernment requires data from God's word and also from a careful study of the spiritual counterfeits themselves. Now, this is not a novel idea. I believe that we find our example for this in the apostles. They are our models. So for example, in Acts 17, 16 to 34, what is Paul doing on Mars Hill? He is skillfully employing his knowledge of pagan philosophies in evangelizing unbelievers. And in their epistles, Paul and Peter and John, for example, all use their familiarity with the false teachings of Judaizers and early Gnostics to expose them and refute them. You can't effectively warn people about something you don't know about, that you don't understand, that you haven't given careful attention to in order to respond appropriately. Next. So I believe that the apostles did a kind of apologetics research. They had to carefully gather information to correctly understand and analyze false teachings and the arguments behind them so they could answer the errors, as I've just said, warn the body of Christ, and call those who are spreading dangerous deception. It's too late to get Joseph Smith, but not too late to get his missionaries. To call them to repentance and true faith. Next. And next again. So we must disciple believers, my brothers and sisters, for discernment as I close, in four important ways. First, to identify dangerous cultic groups and teachers and teachings. To mark them out, as Scripture says. Second, understand them. Don't just condemn them, understand them. How their claims and practices depart from biblical Christianity. Third, we must answer their claims and their practices from Scripture and other evidences. And then we must evangelize their followers sensitively and strategically. Now, again, I've been sort of preaching to the converted because I think that next, a shining example of such work was our late brother, Dale Ratzlaff. Again, as someone who's been in this field a very long time, I find few people who have so embodied the kind of response to error that we see explained in Scripture. He faithfully modeled serious scholarship in short supply in almost every age. Accuracy, clarity, accessibility, fairness. That was Dale. He modeled a humble and gracious tone toward his opponents, who were numerous. He spoke the truth in love. And he had a consistent focus on Christ and the good news. Brothers and sisters, may we go forth and do likewise. Thank you.
Things I need to set up here real quick. We've got some slides here. Let me unpack a few goodies. Don't travel too far without my Ellen White books. Right? I really don't. I'm not even joking. I'm really serious. Gotta keep my spirit of prophecy close. All right. Where Ellen White is, here's her green cord, too. All right. Now, we've had a lot of really good talk. I mean, I had no idea, you know, up until fairly recently, what people were going to be talking on in terms of the Adventists and the unbelief. And we've had some excellent talks already on certain aspects of the unbelief of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring it around, bring it home. Because everything that we've talked about so far is very serious. And I'm going to bring some aspects of Adventism here to the table to show here's what Seventh-day Adventism teaches. And that's why I brought their books. You know, like I always say to Adventists, Adventists always like to tell me on YouTube, why don't you go talk to a pastor? I don't need to talk to a pastor. I can read the spirit of prophecy, right? I read your books from your authoritative sources who are still current today. And I just read and I learn, and then I'll compare and contrast those to the Word of God. And when I do that, that's when it gets serious. And really the point of this talk I'm a member of Mormonism Research Ministry, right? I've been following them for decades. And in this January, February of 2023 is an account here. And one of the members of Mormonism Research Ministry is talking about his Old Testament professor, a person who contributed to the NIV, someone who knows the Bible, who came back to school one day when he was in ministry and said, I got to come back to my class and confess. I was on an airplane. I sat next to a Mormon. We talked about faith the whole time. I knew what he was saying was wrong, but I couldn't put my finger on it. I didn't know what to do. This is a scholar and translator of the NIV. He didn't know what to do. And the point of this article here is there's a reason for counter-cult ministry. Go to those that do know, because sometimes these groups are so deceptive. And I was talking to my friend Angel, and I said, yeah, they speak in code when they speak at these books. That, and you've heard the analogy before. Oh, if I don't need to study all these religions, if I'm just familiar with the Word of God, just like the counterfeit money example, you've heard that analogy? This is how they teach the Secret Service, you know. They teach your Secret Service agent to become so familiar with the real dollar bills, 20s, and et cetera, that when a fake one comes along, oh, they can spot the fake in a minute, and that's how some people's approach to the Word of God is. And he talks about that in the article here. Well, I want to bring another little aspect of that article that he doesn't know that I do. When I was right out of high school, I used to work at a bank. I used to count hundreds of thousands of dollars every week. I would count literally, you know, $200,000 worth of 20s, you know, $50,000 worth of 10s, and this was before they had machines. I could count money faster than any Vegas person can deal chips. I still can today. And I know what they mean when they talk about counterfeits, because I could feel it in my hand. If it slipped through, oh yeah, I could pick a counterfeit in a minute. But here's where this analogy falls apart. And here's something you're going to learn today. You can have a U.S. bill in your hand composed of all non-counterfeit parts and be a counterfeit bill. Did you catch what I just said? The paper's real. It's real paper. By the way, when you go to the bank, and I still do this today, don't count corners, count faces. That's what they taught me in the bank. Did you catch what I said? Don't look at the corners of the bills. Because back in my day, they would cut the corners off of a $100 bill, put them on a $1 bill, and pass it off. It's all composed of original material. It's not counterfeit in that sense. That's where that counterfeit analogy falls apart. You can have something composed of the real. You gotta go to people who know what's going, and that was really the point of his article. You gotta know what's going on. So, I'm gonna start here on my first slide with this magazine right here. Adventist Review Magazine. I'm gonna show you Adventist literature. I'm gonna compare it to the Word of God. I'm gonna let the Word of God describe the seriousness of the unbelief in Adventism. By the way, in my house, I've got my Daniel and Revelation scholarly books outnumber anything by far, right? For obvious reasons to this group. And I get sick to my stomach every time I open one of them up and I find they're quoting so-and-so from Andrews University, and favorably, all the time. Christian publishers publishing Adventist authors. I buy those books all the time, so no one else gets them. Right? In Christianity, there is a sense that Adventism is just fine. I encounter this all the time. I'm like, no, stop it. Our scholars need to quit citing Adventists favorably, especially in Daniel and Revelation books, which they do all the time. There are a couple three. Talbot is the one that comes to mind, who cite them appropriately, but not many. I mean, I run into this all the time. The scholarly community doesn't get it right. Our pastor community doesn't get it right. Some of you know. You go and tell your pastor, I'm a former Adventist, and they'll look at you and go, so? You left one Christian faith to come to another one, right? No. And the average Christian I run into just doesn't get it. That's what this is for. Right here, to show the seriousness of the unbelief that is within Adventism. And by the time you see these slides and you see what Adventism teaches, you see what the Bible teaches, I hope everybody that sees this, both here, now, and in the future, says, okay, this is serious. Adventism is not Christian, and it's not. Amen. I am going to quote from Adventist books, because I'm going to go to the source. Here's a magazine. What does Adventism say about all the stuff they publish? This is recent, General Conference. What do they say here? God, you know, oh yeah, like God sent an answer to Ellen White. You must print this little paper. the Advent Review, right? Present Truth. Let's go to the next slide. Review and Herald is who? It's God's publishing house. Ho! There we go, right? Review and Herald, God's publishing house, which is why I love telling Adventists that the Clear Word Bible is God's Bible, right? Published by God's publishing house. I want to go one other step further on the next page. Here's Testimonies of the Church. So I brought all these books with me. Anybody wants to look at them, you can look at them. Testimonies, Volume 7. We are going to look at page 138. Ellen White does me a favor and broadens everything for me. Our publishing work was established by the direction of God under His supervision. Okay, good. Okay, so it's Review and Herald, it's Pacific Press, it's Southern Publishing, on. Okay, it's God's stuff now. Okay, wonderful. I'm going to look at God's stuff here. So I'm going to take my first point here. Adventism, it's twice cursed by the Word of God. Verse 8, even if we or an angel from heaven, or three angels, should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. And the Apostle Paul says it again, let him be accursed. You preach another gospel, you are twice cursed. Well, did Adventism preach another gospel? Well, let's look here. Let's go to their source. I like General Conference books, right? Doesn't get any higher ex cathedra here, right? Doesn't get any higher source than this book, which is exactly the same book you see on the photograph. Let's go to the next slide. This is chapter 13 of this book, The Mission to the Remnant. And your mission as a remnant in the Seventh-day Adventist Church is to preach the three angels' messages. I am not going to have time to go over each and every one of these angels, but you just look at the amount of text on this page for just the first angel. The gospel message of just the first angel. Let's go to the next slide. We go to the second angel. Look at, they spilled a lot of ink to describe their gospel. And by the way, I've done this. I'm probably going to make more videos on their gospel. Let's go to the third angels on the next page. Page 200, page 201. That's their gospel message. So what I am going to do is, let's go to the next slide. I'm just going to focus on the first angel and that angel's gospel message. Here's one aspect of that message. The fact of the hour of his judgment has arrived. Gee, what do you think that means in terms of code and Adventism? It's called 1844 Investigative Judgment. Every Adventist knows that. The average Christian reading that is just going to read right over that and go, uh-huh, ho-hum. Nah, that's a really key important verse. Let's go to the next page. And what does this first angel call? Message calls attention to the fourth commandment. You got to keep the gospel message is investigative judgment, 1844, the fourth commandment. This first angel, it says here in the lower part of the red text, is what? Therefore calls for the restoration of true worship by presenting before the world Christ the Creator as Lord of the Bible Sabbath. So that's just two pieces. You saw all that text on all those previous pages, right, which we don't have time to go over. That's just their first gospel angel, and that's just two aspects of that angel's gospel message. So, let me say this. There's only one biblical gospel. Let's go to the next slide. The Apostle Paul tells us, Apostle Paul says here in Galatians 1, 11 through 12, that this gospel that he's preached, he goes, it's not man's gospel. And he says, he received it through revelation of Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to tell us, well, what did he receive? That. Just think about what you just saw in this book. You just saw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of words, the Adventist gospel. Here's the Christian gospel. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. It's the gospel which saves you, is what it says, additionally to that. Next. You saw this already. And to preach a gospel other than the gospel to which the Apostle Paul both received, and you see where he received it from, and preached, is to be twice cursed. Seventh-day Adventism, just right here, is twice cursed. And I often say to Adventists, are you comfortable being in a religion that the Word of God has placed two curses upon? Are you? And I usually will just say that and drop it and just walk away. Right? Let them think about it. Again, I mentioned this probably last time I was here. I like Greg Kokel's little saying, just put a pebble in their shoe. Put a pebble in their shoe. Right? Are you comfortable with that? But their religion is twice cursed. This is not a Christian religion. Again, scholars, pastors, other Christians who are not familiar with it, like those of you here, come to those of us that are. Because a lot of this stuff, again, is written in code. All right, next. They're cursed again. Galatians 3:10. For all who rely on the works of the law are cursed. Do Adventists rely on the law? Yes. They're cursed. This is a reference back to Deuteronomy in the Old Testament. Okay. Well, the Word of God says, if you rely on the law, you're cursed. So let's just see. Do they teach a reliance on the law? Well, let's look here at this Adventist Review magazine. October of 1994, Revelation 14, a remnant, they want a remnant who doesn't merely profess to keep the commandments, but one that really does. All right, again, read Galatians 3:10. You're relying on the law, you're under a curse, and here they are in their magazine teaching them to rely on the law. You're cursed. This next one is my favorite one, which I use all the time. I'm going to start at the top where it says, in John 15:10, Jesus tells us he kept his Father's commandments. He did not say, I'm trying to keep them, but he says, I have kept them. So it's not enough that we try to keep the commandments. We must keep them. Must. The character of the saints is not established by their failures to keep the commands of God, but their success in doing so. Here's the punchline. Those who simply try to keep the commandments are moral cripples. Review and Herald magazine, December of 1889, calling their own people moral cripples if they don't keep the commandments. It's like, wow. That pretty much hits the heart of it. So Adventism, yeah, they do teach. We can go to the next slide. They do teach a reliance on the law. As you just saw in just these two, I got dozens of these kind of quotes, by the way. I just don't have time to share everything I got. I got dozens. So yeah, they do. Now, here we are now. Adventism got three curses on them. And I always say to my Adventist friends, are you comfortable being in a religion where the Word of God now has placed three curses upon your head? You should not feel comfortable. And I've told them, you shouldn't feel comfortable at this. You answer that question for me. It's up to you. Next. That's a good one. Doctrines of demons. Right? And I think, Paul, you mentioned this passage. Spirit expressly says, in later times, some are going to depart from the faith, devoting themselves to deceitful spirits, doctrines of demons, who do a couple things. Forbid marriage, abstinence from food. The Seventh-day Adventism, did they ever forbid marriage of some type and abstinence from food? Well, yes. Let's look here. Ellen's famous book, Selected Messages, book number 2. We're going to look at two pages. We're going to look at page 343 and 344. And what does she say on page 343? But there is an objection to the marriage of the white and the black. And then she goes on to say, oh, it's a disadvantage. You know, the children are going to have problems and stuff. I'm going to tell you what happens every time I use this. Every Adventist will come back and go, oh, you don't understand. She's just saying that for the time. Because, you know, at that time it was just, you know, you didn't do that. It was just a message for the time. I'd say, yeah, okay, turn the page. Because I did. Let's look at page 344. In reply to inquiries regarding the advisability of intermarriage between Christian young people of the white and black races, she's going to say, I will say to them in my earlier experience, the question was brought before me by the light given me of the Lord. Oh no, it's not for the time. It's the light given me of the Lord where this direction came from. So it's not just for the time, as Adventists like to say. Then I point them right to that says, that's not what she said. It's the light given me by the Lord. All right, we can go ahead and go to the next one. I jumped ahead here where I pointed that out. And then she goes, no encouragement of these, you know, should be given among our people. She doubles down on it. Don't do it. Let's go to the next one. But what does the Word of God say if you're a Christian? There's no don't marry the black people, don't marry the white people. We're all equal. If you're in Christ, financial-wise, race-wise, we're all equal. Doesn't matter. And that's what I often tell Adventists. Hey, by the way, I've already got the light from the Lord on this. I didn't find it here. I got it here. You know, 1900 years before. Here. It's done. Let's go to the next doctrine of demons. Testimonies, volume 9. All right? Those that don't know, right, there's a 9-volume set. Let's look at page 112. Oh, the teachings of the health reform. Right? As people, you can see the first underlying group in red. We've been given, as a people, we've been given the work of making known the principles of health reform. And then you can read on down. They're needed to show, right, to keep people away from unhealthy foods. Don't use tea, coffee, flesh food, right? Don't arouse those animal passions, right? As she would say, right? The health reform is the Lord's means. Right here on the bottom is the Lord's means. And then she goes on to say, the work bears the signature of heaven. Abstinence from food bears the signature of heaven. Okay. It's like, you sure you want to say that? Let's go to the next one. And we're going to keep reading down that page on the right-hand side. Notice the word she uses here. It's not mine, it's hers. Abstinence from all hurtful food and drink is the fruit of true religion. What did that Bible verse we just read say? Doctrines of demons is what? Abstinence from food. And what did she just say here? Abstinence from food. Doctrine of demons. Next slide. There it is again. Doctrines of demons is what? Forbidding marriage and abstinence from food, both of which are taught in these official books, which you can still buy today. All right, let's go to the next one. This is the one that I find really sickening. And I say, Adventism is Antichrist. And I know that offends Adventists when I say that. I say, let me explain to you why and how I can say what I say. Who is the liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? Jesus is the Messiah. Right? This is Antichrist. Well, how do Adventists deny Jesus is Messiah? Do it right here in this book. I quoted this book last year. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357. I quote it all the time. I just got it memorized. And what did Ellen White say? Read this quote. If you've never seen it, read this. The blood of Christ, while it too was released the repentant sinner from the condemnation of the law, was not to cancel the sin. Okay, so where was the sin going to stand then? Follow along with her. She says, it, that's the sin, would stand on record in the sanctuary until the final atonement. Did you catch what she just said? Final atonement. And the sin stands in the sanctuary, which began when again? 1844? So what? How many sins did Christ die for in Adventism on the cross? Zero. None. You deny the work of Christ. I've got dozens and dozens of these quotes, by the way. I mean, I literally in my Microsoft Word file probably have 6, 7, or 8 pages of Adventists denying the work of Christ on the cross. It's one of the most sickening things. Here's just another one, like I said, of the many that I have. It, the work of Christ on the cross, cannot be accomplished before. Right? There is no atonement before. As this is the atonement that's in the closing act of Christ. He goes on to say, it's the 1844. Nothing happened before 1844 in terms of sins being forgiven. Christ didn't die for a single sin on the cross. All sins were stored and collected until Christ showed up in 1844. Then investigative judgment, Levitical priest Jesus opened up the books and he starts judging. Right? That's it. No. And again, I know Adventists are offended by this because Adventists will say, oh, Christ died on the cross for my sins. They say it to me all the time. I go, no, he didn't. I go, either you're going to agree with me and we're both going to be in agreement that this woman here is a heretic, and what she wrote is Antichrist, or you're going to believe with her. And you know what? Most of the time, guess what Adventists do? They go right here. Most of the time they do. They'll act like they don't know this, and when I make them informed of it, I watch them flip in a minute, and they'll start defending Ellen White. Well, you see, it's this, and Daniel 8:14, 2300, it's really, you know, days and years, and it's like, oh, they go off. They'll start defending it. I said, that's Antichrist. You're denying the work of the Messiah. All right, next slide. Seventh-day Adventism is cursed, doctrines of demons, and Antichrist. Again, Seventh-day Adventists, are you comfortable being in a religion with Antichrist doctrines? I hope not. And again, Christian scholars, publishers, are you comfortable quoting or looking favorably on a religion whose cursed doctrines of demons and teaches Antichrist? I hope not, because this message needs to get out there. Next. Ellen White is an abomination to God with what she's done, period. Why? Because God said, if you do these things, you're an abomination to me. There shall not be found among you those who will practice divination, sorcery, charms, mediums. Ellen White is a full-on medium. Necromancer, someone who inquires of the dead. Well, that's interesting. Let's go to the next slide. I know some of you are familiar with this book, Retirement Years, right? And all this hubbubaloo and Adventism. Oh, we're so afraid of spiritualism. Your spirit of prophecy was talking to the dead. And it's in this book. James White died. And then recently after his death, he shows up and it says in a dream. Now, and I'll address the dream part of it. He shows up and starts giving her career advice. What to do, what not to do. He gives her some words of comfort. This is all recorded in this book. Let's go to the next slide. She calls him. She's excited when she sees him. She calls him father, right? Term of endearment. I think that these two had. She goes, why, father, I explain. I'm so happy to see you by my side once again. Has the Lord pitied me and let you come back to me? I saw Martin's talk earlier, and Ecclesiastes 9:5, aren't you dead? And go to sleep? Dad's dead? James White came back. Right? He didn't know about Ecclesiastes 9:5. Right? He came back and talked to Ellen White and gave her career advice. I'm just going to jump through the end. There's like three or four pages where all this career advice is given. And we get to the end of it, and really what he tells her is, don't go to Battle Creek. Get out of the conference. Save your life. Devote your time to writing. Go to California. Just relax. So she comes back and says, now you can see and understand why I have no duty to go to Battle Creek. Because who told me? The Lord told me. Whoa, what kind of dream is that? It's not a dream now, is it? I often say to my Adventist friends, dreams and visions are used in Seventh-day Adventism as interchangeable terms. Ellen White classified dreams for us. I say, thank you, Ellen White. And she did it right here. Look at this next Review and Herald magazine. Let's go one, go one more. There's three kinds of dreams. Common dreams, demonic dreams, God-inspired dreams. Okay. So what kind of dream did Ellen White just have in retirement years? Did she have a common dream? You know, all of us have wacky dreams. We wake up and go, wow, that was some crazy stuff. Crazy, right? Wacky. No, we're not going to look at that and say, that's from the heavenly realm. Or demonic dreams, or God-inspired dreams. Well, she just told us what it was. It's number three. She said, the Lord forbade me to go back to Battle Creek, and she heads out to California. That's a God-inspired dream. So, by her own categories. Let's go to the next one. This was one of my favorite video series to do. Ellen White's practicing witchcraft. The Green Cord. She had another dream. It's called the Green Cord Dream. And I bought this book. I saw this title, Green Cord Dream, and I thought, oh, this is going to be awesome. You know, this thing's going to tell me all about the Green Cord Dream. Oh, gosh. What a disappointment. It had the actual dream in here, you know. And then it just goes off, and it's like a pop psychology book, really, is all it is. I mean, I totally read this. I'm like, what a, you know, false advertising. You know, they're not about the green card. But anyway, Ellen White, in this dream, and her guide, she met her guide. And as she was leaving, as she met Christ, and she's coming back, her guide gave her a green cord and told her, you want to see Jesus again? Stretch this across your chest. Don't get it tangled. Don't get it knotted. I did a whole video series on this. Cord magic. And I come to find out, cord magic goes back to the Egyptians and the Hittites. Thousands of years before Christ. This is an ancient art of witchcraft. I even wrote the White Estate and said, where's Ellen White's green cord? Because they talk about it like it's really physical. So I wrote them. I said, where is it? I want to see it. Is it on display somewhere? And they wrote me back and said, no, it's not real. I'm like, yeah. They said, it's spiritual. It doesn't really exist. But they talk about it like it exists. So if you've seen my videos, I contacted a witch on Etsy. And I said, make me a green cord. And here it is. And you look at the green cord and the green cord book, and you look at these two, and you go, I wonder if they use the same witch when they made, I mean, they're like identical. So, yeah, I contacted a witch and said, make me a green cord. There it is. All right, next slide. God said, if you do these things, you're an abomination to me. Witchcraft. Green cords, talking to the dead. You're an abomination to God. So again, to the Seventh-day Adventist, you're in a religion that your spirit of prophecy is an abomination to God. Are you comfortable with that? And again, Christian community, we don't want to be supporting this religion who's an abomination to God. That's got to stop. Scholars, stop citing Adventist literature. Christians, if you've got Seventh-day Adventist neighbors, they're not just Christians who go to church on a different day. This is a field ripe for evangelism. It's how you ought to look at it. And there's so much more I could say. I could get into dowsing. You know what a dowser is? She hired a dowser. A water witch is another word for it. You hire some guy with a stick who walks around and he's in tune with the forest, and the stick goes, whoop, dig here, there's water. When she built a sanitarium in San Diego. Water witching. I mean, phrenology. I was telling a friend of mine back here, you saw a quote earlier today where Satan was described about his broad forehead? That's phrenology. Phrenology. That's where some doctor is going to come to you, put his hands on your head and say, I can tell your character by the shape of your head. That's phrenology. That's a future video I'm going to do on that. All right. Let me wrap this up here. Seventh-day Adventism is twice cursed for its gospel. It's cursed again for a third time for its reliance on the law. It teaches doctrines of demons, right? Separation of the races. Don't marry. Blacks and whites shouldn't marry. Abstinence from food. That's doctrine of demons. And its spirit of prophecy is an abomination to God for her witchcraft, dowsing, talking to the dead. I hope it's really clear. Adventism is not Christian, and the unbeliefs that they have are, these are serious unbeliefs. We're not talking about minor stuff. This is very serious unbelief. So anyway, thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Paul and Jim. I think Jim may know more about Adventism than many of us. Some of us didn't dig quite that deep, and some of us don't want to. Well, we're going to reset for our Q&A, so stay around. Just a few minutes, maybe 5 minutes, and we'll have this opportunity for you to ask questions. So start thinking about the questions you want to ask, And we will come around with a mic, and you'll get to ask them live and get to hear your answers.
For
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul.
Let's just sing that verse again so we all get it.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'm not one. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul.
Men follow me in the women's partisan,
and I will trust. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me home.
Right, let's stand together and sing the second verse. Can we stand?
He guides my ways in righteousness. And he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice as we lift his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come and rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in you.
I think we're ready to start the Q&A, if you could find your seat, and we will start immediately. Do you have your questions ready? Okay, on our panel is, if you've just come in this evening, this is Colleen Tinker, my wife, editor of Proclamation and all things written, and she's also with Nikki Stevenson. Together, they're on the Former Adventist podcast. And then Caspars, you've met him, I think. He's professor at Southern Seminary. And Jim Baber is a professor and apologist in charge of Academy Apologia. And Martin Carey is, well, what are you doing now? He says he's semi-retired and probably means he's working twice as hard. But what was that? Oh, yes. Martin Carey is also a board member of our ministry, as, along with Caspars. Thank you. So, does anybody have a question?
I'll be here later. No.
I got a question on Walter Martin.
You got to wait for the mic because we have online people.
I got a question, Paul, about Walter Martin, and why didn't it come out with a formal retraction afterwards to say he made a big mistake about Adventism, and we want to now set the record straight for all the Christian community?
So let me be succinct. A lot of us were compelled to leave the Christian Research Institute in 1995. So it's difficult for me to say what goes on in the minds of those in charge of CRI. And now, what, 30 years later almost. So Walter Martin had some problematic positions. As soon as he died, which was sudden, by the way, he was in poor health, but he died suddenly in June of 1989. The staff scrambled to scuttle his materials on two subjects, abortion and hypnotism. Nobody on his research staff agreed with his views on those two topics. But Adventism was not touched because the Martinist view, if we could call it that, persisted. And of course, now the Christian Research Institute is being led by a man who's become Eastern Orthodox, a man who has defended the Living Stream movement, the local Church of Witness Lee, which tried to destroy multiple Christian ministries, most notably Harvest House Publishers, suing them for over $100 million. So I don't think they are likely to be in any hurry to absolve Adventism of anything. But this is just my opinion.
Thank you. All right, this is to the panel. Ellen G. White started in 1863, it was just her and some of the founders. And now it's 23 million people, so surely 23 million people can't be wrong. I mean, it shows that it has to go ahead and be. In fact, it's one of the fastest growing American religions in the world. So it has to show that there is some, it's divine. So how would you go ahead and respond to that?
All right. Yeah, that's a very common question I get all the time, Greg, online as a proof of Adventism and its growing numbers. Let me just say something about its growing numbers. This just came out. There, I think it's 2022, maybe 2023, statistical report just came out. And it was Dirk Anderson just wrote an article on it. I have someone on that's been supporting me and my channel since like the very beginning. He just alerted me to this. I did a video on the statistics of Seventh-day Adventism probably 2 years ago. And they had Seventh-day Adventism is retaining about 49% of its new members. All right? So for, you know, half of them are walking out the back door when one comes in the front. That number now has gone up to 66%. They're not growing. I wrote the statistical office of David Trim of the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference because I've looked at their reports because Greg well knows, and I've done this for years with Jehovah's Witnesses because they do the same. They report statistical numbers. And here's what they don't do in Seventh-day Adventism that we were always questioning Jehovah's Witnesses. When I wrote the statistical office of the General Conference, I said, how do you factor in the birth rate? You know, Dick and Jane Adventists have two children who get baptized at 10 and 12 years old. Oh, those are two new members. They're really not new members. It's just the birth rate. I said, how do you factor in the birth rate in terms of your new conversion numbers? And they said, basically, they don't. So when I look at those numbers, they're really not growing all that much. It's an internal birth rate. Yeah, they are bringing in some people, true, but it's not as high as they want to say. And now they're losing 66% of what they got, up from 49%. No, it's not growing so fast. And of course, we know growth rate is not equal to truth. If that was true, then Islam is the most truest religion in the world. Right? So that, you know, it's a crazy argument. Anybody else want to?
That it seems that most of those additions come from not North America. They come from Africa and perhaps South America. But so yes, the backdoor thing is not publicized, but I have also read that these giant baptisms that evangelists do in Africa, they start to realize that the same person is being baptized every time there's a new evangelistic effort, you know, they come through. And they're counted, of course. So.
Can I just add something really quickly? It's already basically been said, but the test of truth is the Word of God. Mm-hmm. It's never the numbers. It's never the masses or the group think. Look at how the world thinks right now. I feel like the world has lost their mind. That's not a testimony of truth.
And look at our little tiny church here, just a half mile from a very giant Adventist church.
Hi, thank you. I'll stand up so you guys can see me. My name is Allison, and I left Adventism about a year-ish ago. And to the gentleman right here, it took me about 8 months to get my name removed from their books. So I'm assuming that there are many, many people, probably even people in this room, who still have their name on the books. And just, you're being counted in the numbers. And it mattered to me to at least take one drop out of the bucket. And also in terms of Adventism growing, being divine, I heard some number, 20% of young people now are LGBTQIA+. Is that a divine appointment of growth? Like Nikki said, the world is crazy. So I just wanted to respond to that. And I know it's really confusing and it's really hard to leave Adventism and everyone here is a miracle. But I just had a question in terms of how, you know, like when Jim was talking tonight, I'm thinking most of the Adventists I know, including my sister and I, really didn't know what Ellen White said. I'm sure if I were to show people what she said about, you know, interracial marriage, they'd just be aghast. But you're right. I don't know if they would do away with her after that. There's a lot of cognitive dissonance. But I guess what my question is, to the Southern California brand of Adventism that is very, it looks very evangelical. You know, you go to these churches, you guys know which ones they are. there's coffee, there's cool music, there's saved by grace through faith, there's we know Sabbath doesn't save you, we don't care what day you worship, we're just worshiping here on Saturday, and you know, Sabbath is you know, God's provision, and spend it how you want. If you want to go to, you know, a concert on Sabbath and that's your rest, like, that's cool, man. Like, it's very cool and it's very welcoming and it's very evangelical Calvary Chapel vibes. So how do we evangelize to those people who, you know, I literally had a friend say, like, every church has its problems, this is just the weird, every church is weird, this is just the weird that I know, you know? And I'm like, oh, all those other churches, you know, prosperity gospel and, oh, Pentecostals, we're gonna stay here in our corner with Adventism. And I don't know, it frustrates me. And I think it holds people in darkness, but I can't put my finger on it. So that's my question. How do we address that brand of Adventism that is very, almost like the antithesis to what Ellen White even wrote about? Like, they don't like her. So.
Well, I'll start, and I expect help. Okay. So, number one, this is hard to define if you're not really clear on it, but I can't get out of my head how well Caspar's explained the false Christ in Adventism. What he said this morning, if you heard him, should be actually extremely helpful, because Adventism has a unique worldview. And the worldview is based on a non-Trinity, and I don't care what brand of Adventism it is, they all believe in a non-Trinity. They will say it's the Trinity, but it is not the Trinity of the Bible. Their Jesus is fallible. Their Jesus is not omnipresent. Their God is probably physical because, you know, they look like him in his image. So they believe that, and that's not a biblical God, and it's not a biblical Jesus. And along with that is their disbelief in their own nature. They have no idea they are dead. I had no idea I was dead. I did not know that the purpose of my living for God was not to become obedient and good, but it was to become alive. I had no idea I needed to be made alive. So that is why they can sit in these various kinds of churches and be just fine, thank you, because they still have a worldly worldview, a pagan worldview, let's be honest. Because it's a false God, it's a false view of themselves, a false understanding of sin, because without understanding that they're dead, their sin is just giving into the, you know, the devil that's on their shoulders, you know. And their salvation then is learning to say no to the devil and say yes to the commandments. That's not a worldview that's from the Bible. So how do you evangelize them? Well, I don't know exactly, because they have to be willing to hear. But as Richard has often said, the really true blue historic Adventists who believe it's true are more likely to understand and embrace the true gospel when they hear it, because they want to do the right thing. These kinds of Adventists are looking for, I'm sorry I sound so judgy, but I was there, you know, and I know how it is. But they are actually looking for a way to assuage their conscience without facing their sin. And they don't actually know that, but at some deep level they do. And at what was it Gary said this morning? That which they cannot suppress, they will manipulate. And I just thought that was profound. Please help me.
That was a really good answer. Can I ask the room if the kind of Adventism that she described is the kind of Adventist that you were? Okay, so it can happen. We can get them. And I think it's really, we just have to keep teaching scripture accurately, drawing them to the truth of Christ, of what he did, of who we are, all the gospel essentials and not let them take us down rabbit trails of tradition and culture, and we're like you, and you got to have them put down those arguments if they're willing to talk to you at all about it. But I think sometimes trying to go after Adventists who aren't interested in being rescued is like going into a bar and trying to convince everybody there that they have a drinking problem. Yeah. They're in the middle of enjoying their problem. So we need to pray for them to know their need.
I'll just add quickly that, you know, you can downplay heresy and a false gospel and smooth it over, ignore it, but that doesn't automatically land you into the truth of the true gospel. And so I think a lot of progressive Adventism is happy saying, I don't believe in Ellen White, I don't believe all of that, but their entire worldview, unknown to them, has been shaped by this, and they need to now renounce this false gospel and move into the true gospel. And it, as far as evangelizing, I think one thing that could be really good is to expose their gospel and expose what they believe. And so you could have an open-ended question to them. What is the Bible about? What is the central message of the Bible? What is the gospel? And I think inevitably most of them are going to be talking about good behavior, being a good person, having a good relationship with God. And then all you have to go is to 1 Corinthians 15 and say, this is Paul's gospel, describes it there. He says this is of first importance. And then also go to Galatians and say, if someone else proclaims a different gospel than this, he's accursed. It's a very serious, serious thing. It's not a light matter. And that perhaps could turn on the light bulb, let them see that there's something about this here that they're missing, I would say.
Especially if they feel like they really know they're missing something.
So I encounter this kind of Adventist all the time. I mean, I start my day off every day with a cup of coffee, and I fire up my computer, and I talk to Adventists for an hour to 2 hours every day. This is really, I've been doing this for 5 years now. I talk every day. So I get these kind of Adventists, and this is what I typically do. So first, they're willing to talk. That's good. You know, not like what Nikki said. And Nikki's absolutely right. If you're not willing to talk, not much I can do, right? But they've engaged me. So I will stick with, these are my two go-to issues. Who's Jesus? What is the gospel? That's it. And, you know, so sometimes I'll start with these Adventists, and they'll say, well, I don't believe. I'll ask them, do you affirm the 28 beliefs? Your church manual on page 45 and 46 says, before you get baptized, you will first affirm the fundamentals belief of the church, and then you will agree to these baptismal vows. I'll go, okay, did you do that? Do you agree with the belief? So I'll start there sometimes, and I'll let them, right? And it'll still take me to the right place. Chapter 24 of 28 is investigative judgment. It's investigative judgment Jesus. Or I'll go to chapter 13 in the book, which is the mission of the remnant, which is their everlasting gospel. But I stick on those two issues. Those two issues matter. I don't care about, you know, if you eat eggs or butter or use condiments, right? No. Doesn't matter. I'm going to stick on the two important issues. And that's what I'll... right, they can make the claim, oh, I don't Ellen White this or that. I'll go right back and say, who's your Jesus and what is your gospel? That's it. That's the only two places I need to go. And then, of course, you know, I'm ready to answer those things and show from their literature, this is your Jesus, this is your gospel. And I can, just like I did in the presentation, when you compare that to the Word of God, you're in serious trouble. These are serious matters. So I those are two places I go. Sometimes I'll start with the 28 beliefs book. Sometimes I'll talk about baptismal vows. I think it's baptismal vow number 8 is the baptismal vow to Ellen White, right? The spirit of prophecy. So I'll start asking if they start denying their vows. And sometimes they will, but...
Well, they do in many areas of their lives,
do.
You know.
Okay, we have another question.
All right. In November 7 of 2023, the Spectrum magazine published an article talking about some, probably around 19 scholars meeting, and the title, including George Knight, by the way, in the group. And the title of the article was Ellen White Scholars See Crisis in Call for Change. And the big take from this article was we had to reposition Ellen White on her place to survive as an organization. And I'm taking from myself and for my kids or whoever, back four generations as Seventh-day Adventists, we saw a lot of popes coming in and coming out. Where's the Sunday law? And the young generation are asking this question to their parents, saying, the big promise of the church is not happening. And I think Ellen White has a big take on this, and these callers now are kind of turning the yellow or red light on. So what is your take on this repositioning process of Ellen White in the organizations starting last year, let's say?
Well, I did not read the article, so I haven't read how they're proposing a repositioning. But I can tell you this from the word repositioning, it is not a renouncing. And the fact is, unless there's a renouncing of her, there can't be a change. And they can't renounce her, as Angel Rodriguez so famously admitted back in the late 90s, because to renounce her, to get rid of her, would mean the entire organization would crumble, because their central pillar doctrine only is found in her. So whatever they do, they're not going to collapse the organization. But if they did, let's just say, you know, Richard and I talk about this because we watch Loma Linda University Church sometimes because, you know, they're here. And let's just say that they decided to shove her off to the side or to reframe her importance or to cut off and start their own. This is not going to change anything because they still have their worldview. They still have their physicalist worldview, and that is so important to them. They still do not understand who Jesus is. He is not the eternal Son. He is not. And the worldview is going to, you know that old, that phrase, which I think is so helpful sometimes, wherever you go, there you are. That's kind of true. And unless they actually say, I want to know what's true, and get to the real gospel and the real Jesus, they're just going to take their Adventism rebranded wherever they go. So a repositioning is not a renouncing. That's just my response to that.
All right, we have another question.
Yeah, I'm kind of an outsider. Been out of it for 39 years, so it's hard to get a tap on where they're at right now. But I just wonder if you guys see anything new emerging within the Adventist that's maybe changing it, maybe causing its foundations to be reevaluated. Anything along those lines you guys may have a comment on?
I think they're realizing now. I mean, like I said, I've been on this road only for 5 years. I'm the newbie here, and what I've seen in just the 5 years, in terms of the social media increase of those exposing Adventism, it's having an impact, and they're panicking. I've heard from the inside that they know about a lot of us, but they don't want to address us because that's only going to point attention to us, and it's going to drive Adventists to us, who then are going to see, oh my gosh, I got a false gospel and a fake Christ, let me leave. They know that's going to be a problem. They're panicking. They don't know what to do. They're losing, like I mentioned earlier, the departure rate has increased now from 49% to 66%. They're bleeding members. This is not sustainable. Just in terms of just budget dollars, tithes lost, they're going to have to start making cuts soon. And I've seen this happen in other religions. And they're going to do a couple things, I think. They're either going to double down, because I've seen this in Islam. In Islam, when they have problems, they go, we got to go back to our past. We got to go back to our historical roots. Well, I see that happening in Adventism right now. They're going back to their historical roots. They got this Arian problem now in Adventism. They're going back to their roots. Or they're going to try to moderate and become much more liberal. And then I've seen that happen in other religions, and when they do, I think Adventism will start self-destructing, splintering, fragmenting, perhaps. Maybe they'll all stay together, but they won't be a happy remnant group anymore. But yeah, there's problems. They're bleeding members. They know they are. Most of the members they're losing are the 30-somethings and under, because they're on the social medias and they see all the problems and they just leave.
And then the problem is, these are people who don't know the gospel. These are people who are going from one part of the domain of darkness just into another part of the domain of darkness. But, you know, they have with them a framework in their heads that's different from average garden variety unbelief. As my friend Joni Yorba Gray said to us several years ago, after she's never been Adventist, she has translated a lot of our work into Spanish, and she attended a conference several years ago, and she said, I've been in Africa, I've been on mission trips, and she was almost crying, and she said, Adventism is dark. It's dark like Witch Doctor Africa dark. It's not garden variety unbelief. And these fragmenting Adventists are going out into the world carrying their internal worldview that's Witch Doctor Dark. And I know how I sound, but I really know it's true. These are lost people who don't know where to go. And they're preset because of their backgrounds and, you know, just the worldview they came into in their Adventist homes, even if they were not very conservative. They're coming in with this belief that it is the closest thing to the truth, and if that doesn't work, then Christianity is dead. So it's a really sad thing.
Okay, we have another question.
My name is John. I was never Adventist, but my wife is. But I was Mormon for 20 years, so I think I've earned a seat at this table. I've suffered enough. I want to thank you guys for all that you're doing. It's just so vital and so important. First of all, I would like to ask a question for clarification, doctrinally speaking. Does the Adventist church still teach that it is the responsibility of the remnant church in the last days to rise up and to honor God by obeying his law, either perfectly or just really, really well, in order to once and for all silence Satan's accusation that God is unfair and gave a law that could not be obeyed? Has that been in any way diluted or discarded?
No.
Okay. Part two. I didn't
what
think so.
What he said.
Is it true that the consequence, if the remnant church does not rise up and do that, that the authority and the power of God, he has to cede that to Satan, and technically Satan would rule the universe? Is that true? In other words, at the core of the great controversy is the authority of the universe is up for grabs. Is that true?
They don't say it that way.
How would they say it? Am I nibbling at the truth of the matter?
They would say that God's name has been challenged and denigrated by Satan's accusation, and that there is doubt in the minds of course, inhabitants of Earth and the billions and trillions of aliens out there who are watching worlds.
Right, right.
And they, God's name needs to be vindicated. It's got like God is a politician,
right,
who's watching his polls, and he's waiting for his numbers to go up. And those numbers will go up by people perfectly keeping his law, which will vindicate him. That's central to Adventism. It's a pillar.
Can the Adventist church, can the remnant church fail in their mission? Is that on the table? As a sort of a...
Well, by whose standard when you say fail?
Well, I think I read somewhere in the Great Controversy that said that if the remnant church does not step up and vindicate God, that authority is ceded to Satan himself. Hmm. No, maybe not.
I don't think so. No, okay. I think she says that there will be a remnant who will.
Okay.
It's just a matter of time.
Okay. Well, my question was going to be, is the universe up for grabs? And if so, how many Adventists actually believe that?
But. I think that it's it was up for grabs. If I remember my past life, going to the cult. At the cross, I think that God really took a risk. Yes, because if Jesus had failed,
Satan would be the god of the universe, though. So that's true. And I had another question, but I was just going to add to something that Jim said.
Just a minute. There's more.
Sorry. Yeah, I just want to slight add on to this, that there's a young rising professor at Andrews University, John C. Peckham, who's written several books already that have been endorsed by major evangelical figures, and he advocates for the so-called cosmic conflict paradigm, which is really gaining in ascendancy in evangelical circles, the idea that God must follow the rules in the universe, and so he's limited and constrained by certain things. There are other heavenly beings, and so in that sense, that's very eerily similar to the Great Controversy framework, where God needs to be vindicated. He has some issues to deal with. And so I just see, from my perspective, going to ETS and other places, that this kind of cosmic conflict paradigm is increasing in popularity in evangelical circles, and partly that's fueled by Adventism and Adventist scholars who are accepted in evangelical circles.
Can I add now? It's just that we're talking about numbers, you know, and Jim says something about that the numbers are not real. And I have to testify to that, because I've seen something happening in Brazil now, like in the past 2 or 3 weeks. So you have all been to a baptism. You go to a church and there's a baptism happens, and then they go to the tank and they get baptized, and afterwards you see them all coming to the front and everybody's dressed up ready with all the hair wet, and they come and they receive the certificate and sometimes a Bible. You've seen that. Well, in Brazil now, they're giving kitchen appliance, electronics, like, yeah, air fryers, and yes. So I have pictures. Yes. So this is really happening. I never thought that I was going to see that, but it is happening. So they're really worried about the numbers.
It's hard for us to tell because we haven't been in an Adventist church recently.
But, I'm not going to do that. Are you? Okay. Hello. I was having a conversation a while ago with my Adventist roommate at La Melinda regarding the sanctuary doctrine. And one of the things that he said, and I may be misremembering the conversation, it was happening very late in the night, so I could be jumbling some details, but my understanding from what he was telling me is that they believe that the blood pollutes the sanctuary, and that there's a need for the scapegoat to receive sins in order for there to be atonement. Where in the world do they get that idea from?
Yeah, Leviticus, the antitypical Day of Atonement. The big problem with this, I would say, when you look at the Old Testament perspective, is that animals being sacrificed, first of all, there's a broader evangelical conception, partly that, well, the sin maybe somehow gets transferred to this animal. But he is never brought into, that animal's blood is never brought in side to the inner sanctuary. And on the Day of Atonement, that animal is actually taken outside of the camp. So, and that is the only time when there is an explicit explanation that the sins are confessed onto this animal. And so I think it's a warping of the idea that you've got to have a one-to-one correspondence between the Day of Atonement. I think Adventists misunderstand the Day of Atonement, and then they carry that into their investigative judgment doctrine.
Yeah. Can I just comment on that? One thing I'd like to dovetail, piggyback on what Caspar has just said, is that as an Adventist, I didn't understand that the blood of the sacrifices in the Old Testament always cleansed I believed that the blood somehow moved sin around.
Yeah.
From the people to the priest, from the people to the priest to the sanctuary, on the Day of Atonement, from the priest, you know, to that curtain where he sprinkled blood once a year. So that the conception I had as an Adventist was that blood carried sin away from the people and was put in the presence of God. So then that is where they get the idea that Jesus' blood carries sin from the people who claim to believe in him, carries it sin, literally, this is what we're taught, and it's in Ellen's writings, carries the sin, transfers is the word, transfers the sin from the people into the heavenly sanctuary where they are stored in the records until the investigative judgment, when Jesus starts going through the records, and then he sees who's really confessed all their sins, who's really been keeping the law, and if they've, and this is only of believers. This is not of all those unbelievers who didn't profess him. So the believers are now being judged. And if their sins have been confessed, not just like, Lord, I am a sinner. I don't even know all the bad things I've done. Please forgive me. I accept your payment for, it's no, it's like, please forgive me for talking about my car on Sabbath after dinner. Please forgive me for wasting time between my piano practice and my homework because I know idle moments are held against me. And I know I did that on Tuesday. Please forgive that sin. I mean, that's what she said you had to do. And if you didn't, it remained on the record. And he couldn't apply his blood to that sin. But if you did remember to confess it, he could then, in the investigative judgment, apply his blood to that sin. And then that would cover it over, and he'd write pardon or forgiven. I forget, you know, they, I forget the order, but one was, whatever. And then at the end of this judgment, he takes all of those that have been fully confessed and applied the blood and puts them on Satan, who actually deserves the punishment because, you know, he made us do it. So he carries those sins of the saved people out of heaven into the lake of fire and cleanses heaven. I mean, get the impact of that. Satan is the tragic hero of our salvation. He pays the final price for our sin. Now, that is the thumbprint of evil. I don't know how else to say it. So I did not understand that blood always cleanses, always, 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 never carries sin around. It doesn't contaminate, it cleanses.
Okay, we have another question.
Hi, my name is Johanna, and I was just wondering if you all are familiar with the antagonism that Adventists have towards regular believers, and something that I experienced when I was not a Christian. I had come out of Adventism, and I wasn't a believer, but my family and my Adventist friends, they knew that I was a pagan, and they seemed to have no problem with that. But once I became a true believer, then it was like I had to, you know, oh, we have to get her out of this, you know, true Bible-believing church. It's so bizarre. It's like, why? How are they okay with that? It's such a contradiction. It's how can their antipathy be so strong against regular Christians? It's just crazy.
I can only speak to how I thought as an Adventist, but I would have thought, well, if you're in the world, of course I'm doing better than you, so I don't need to worry. And if you became a Christian and left Adventism, you would be making a statement about what I believe now. And now I would feel on the line to defend something I didn't know how to defend.
So I want to say it's their culture and it's their doctrine. The message of the second angel, of the three from Revelation 14, the message of the second angel is, get out of Babylon. Well, that's Adventist code for get out of the Sunday worshiping Christian churches. Adventism has a message really targeted, not to the Buddhists, not to the Muslim, to the Christian churches. They got it really antagonistic. And the third angel says, and when Christ comes back, and if you're worshiping on Sunday and you know you should be worshiping the Sabbath, you get the mark of the beast forever. You're dead. You're done. You're doomed. Right? It's a message against Christianity. She had a really big chip on her shoulder against the Christian church. I often say to Adventists, I had to become a Muslim, I'll never get the mark of the beast. Because your gospel angels say that, well, Muslims are free, Buddhists are free, Sikhs are free.
They don't eat pork.
And they don't eat pork too, right? They observe the health message. Right? You think about their message, it's really targeted to the Christian church. And that whether they know it or not, but I'm going to say subconsciously, I mean, that's their message. That's their gospel message from day one.
Well, I think the issue really is, and this is, again, I'm taking this all the way back to Caspar's this morning, where he identified the Adventist Jesus. They are not Christian. This is only in words. This is only their deception. They claim Christian terms, but they have pagan beliefs, to be honest. They have a different God, a different Jesus, a different man, and a different gospel. And they resonate with non-Christians more than Christians because it's a different spirit. When you're born again, you're transferred out of the domain of darkness into the kingdom of the beloved Son, and there's no middle ground. And if you haven't been transformed by believing in the real Jesus, and I will never forget Paul Carden years ago at one of these conferences saying, if you're not believing in the right Jesus, you are not believing unto salvation. And if they're not believing in the right Jesus, they have more sympathy and understanding for what's going on in the domain of darkness.
I want to add one more thing to that. As an Adventist, Adventists are afraid of Christians. It's built into their doctrine. They're afraid that Christians will persecute them, do all sorts of things. They're the enemy. So we have become the enemy.
Tell them what your mom said.
But my experience is that they're arrogant. They may seem afraid on some level. I'm almost done. No microphone.
The mic.
I perceive that they're arrogant, that they project the opposite of fear. Now, maybe it's the sort of intellectualoid Loma Linda University Adventists who are doing this, the La Sierra Adventists, but I get condescension, not fear.
I can only speak to myself and people that I knew quite well in Adventism. I was afraid of Christians, especially Catholics. I lived in a Catholic neighborhood growing up, and I was afraid every Sabbath when I walked out to the car in my suit, and I knew all those Catholics were watching me get in my car going to church on Sabbath. Yeah. Okay, we have a question here.
Well, this question actually kind of tags along to that. When I was growing up in the Adventist church, and we talked about evangelism, 100% of that evangelism was for people going to other churches. We didn't care about evangelizing the non-believers. We only cared about believing or evangelizing the misbelievers. That's a word I remember from very many years ago, was the misbelievers. They thought they believed in the true God. So those people that were true Christians, they didn't think they were. Because Adventists always said, hey, when you go up to heaven, the people on the other side of that wall, those were everybody that wasn't Seventh-day Adventist, were saying, those are the Adventists over there. They think they're the only ones here. And that's, when I was growing up, that's what I thought. I thought Adventists were the only people that were going to be going to heaven. So the true believers, we needed to get them on our side. So how does that still, now granted, this was grassroots. This was me and people I knew, not the church leadership or stuff. Is that the way they are still going at things? Are they trying to evangelize to those other believers, or are they really trying to bring in non-believers, completely agnostics, atheists, whatever? Are they trying to bring them into the church, or is it mostly still trying to evangelize other believers?
Yeah, I don't know. I can't speak to the statistics or what they're exactly doing precisely, but I think there's a built-in contradiction that goes all the way back, because even and today as well, where you'll have them talking on one hand about anonymous people in the jungles who are responding to the light that they have just received, and they end up in the kingdom of heaven, and on the other hand, you have apostate Protestantism, and they're just lost forever because they failed to receive the truth of the Advent message. So both are somehow true at the same time, and it's clear what they're focusing on. If they can have an anonymous person out here in the jungles who's just responding to the light that he sees in his heart and is saved, then you don't even need to go out and evangelize them. You just need to deal with apostate Protestantism.
And I think, too, it's a reflection of their gospel. So when we think about reaching the lost, we think about bringing them the gospel of Jesus Christ, the 1 Corinthians 15 gospel, that he came and he died, he propitiated for their sins, and that they can have life in him if they trust him. But their gospel, like was pointed out this evening, it's an apocalyptic gospel. Fear God and worship, fear God who created heaven and earth, and come out of her, my people. Keep the Sabbath and get out of the apostate Protestantism. To them, it's as if, I don't know if they acknowledge Paul's gospel, really. But to them, it's like, okay, we're doing the last day work now. That stuff's been done. Now we're moving on and we're doing the last day work.
Just to add to that, in Adventist theology, it's the present truth gospel, right? That's what the gospel of theirs is, the present truth. I have a magazine from 1932, which says this is Bennett saying, we cannot preach the gospel of the Apostle Paul.
Yeah.
Can't do it. Right, so what do they preach? They say, we preach a present truth message for this end time. It's a message given for this time. So yeah, just like what Nikki said, it's exactly what it is. But in Adventist code words, it's present truth.
It's gospel plus.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Okay, I think we have one more question.
I'm encountering something I never thought I would, and these are ex-Adventists that are very hostile to me because I'm an evangelical. And these have left the church, but they see me as a Jerry Falwell kind of representation. And I was quite surprised because they acknowledge that Adventism is a cult, but they look at me in an even more despiteful way than they do of those who are Adventists. And they don't believe in Adventism. And I'm encountering that a lot of folks that grew up in the church and left, but they're not interested in joining a Christian community. And they feel they're self-righteous because they're not part of the Jerry Falwell kind of moral majority. And I wasn't expecting that. That was very disheartening.
You know, I remember years ago, I don't remember exactly, I think Pastor Gary was preaching through part of Revelation, and I remember, well, he was preaching through the letters to the churches, that's what it was, and I remember him saying that there are Christian churches, he specifically said the mainline churches, and I know that that doesn't only apply to mainline churches necessarily today, but he said they have abandoned the reliability of Scripture. They have ceased to believe it is the reliable, inerrant Word of God. And he said when they do that, they lose their adherence to the Bible, actually. And he said his take on it was, I believe that the reason many of those churches are dwindling and becoming less and less is because their candlestick has been removed, as Jesus said they were in danger of, it was in danger of happening. So when I hear about people who have left Adventism and who are Christians, but who, my thought is, where do they put scripture? What is their stance on scripture? Is it reliable? Is it the word of God? And if they have left Adventism and have not actually subjected themselves to really consistent and careful teaching by somebody who honors the Bible, I see a huge danger, and this is one of the things, Richard and I actually talk about this a lot. I actually feel an increasing, and I mean this word, a great grief, when I look around the former Adventist community and see how many of them are not trusting the Bible. They're interpreting it. They're holding themselves over it instead of under it. And you know, I have to say, have they really encountered the real Jesus? Have they really? Do they really know the gospel? It's a really sad thing, and it requires some humility to be taught well.
I think it's all about perspective and where you stand. Because if we think about our culture and how it's shifting so rapidly under our feet, it's very easy to then be called a fundamentalist. And going back to the 1930s, the fundamentalists were just a group of people who wanted to go back to the fundamentals of the Christian faith. And so if you're looking at that perspective, you've been influenced by the culture, then you're going to call someone a fundamentalist. I think that, you know, a lot of circles that I came out of Adventism would call me a fundamentalist because that's the perception they get from their perspective. I mean, I remember when I was an Adventist, I heard this talk about being born again. I thought that's something that Baptists just say. You know, just it's all about the perspective you have, and if you come as an Adventist and you have in some ways a pretty secular sort of physicalist understanding of the world, and so someone who's on fire for God, who's born again, who's singing hallelujah, well, of course, they're a fundamentalist. Yeah.
Okay, I think it's time to close the meeting for the night. So tomorrow morning, 9:30, come on back. And of course, tomorrow is what day?
The Saturday.
The Saturday. Yes. And so our first presentation is on True Rest in Christ by Colleen. So be here or you miss it. And happy Saturday. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day we've had together. Thank you for your word and your truth. I pray for the Adventists who don't know you, please put a hunger in them for the true gospel and for your son who died for them. Bring us back tomorrow now. In Jesus' name, amen.